Let's go.
Rock.
All right.
Siamo al Centre Pompidou, il puntello della Parigi Cool. Ma non ve ne frega niente, voi volete sapere degli Smashing Pumpkins. Avete ragione. E allora facciamoli un po' di storia. Si formano a Chicago nel 1988 dall'incontro del chitarrista Billy Corgan, voce, e del chitarrista solista James Iha. E incontrano la bassista Darcy poco dopo fuori da un locale e si mettono subito a litigare tra di loro. Tutto un programma di com'è l'umore della band. Ma adesso seguitemi dentro il Batomouche per continuare il nostro giro a Parigi. Penserete mica che siamo venuti qua per l'intervista noi. I want to change. What do you got? Notre Dame, come diceva qualcuno, Parigi val bene una messa. Ma proseguiamo il nostro profilo degli Smashing Pumpkins. Estrosi, molto estrosi, ed estroversi? No. Strani, stranissimi, lunatici, ma soprattutto indissimi. È proprio grazie al passaparola del pubblico underground che il primo album d'esordio, registrato per un'etichetta rigorosamente indipendente, Kish, raggiunge il milione di copie vendute. Nel 1990, quando il Nevermind e Nirvana stava spopolando. Difatti le relazioni tra Smashing Pumpkins e Nirvana non sono poi propriamente buone, anche perché Billy Corgan ha spesso avuto relazioni con la moglie di Kurt Cobain, Courtney Love. Con alle spalle la modernissima piramide del Louvre, riprendiamo la storia delle nostre zucche. Nel 1993 esce il loro secondo album, Siamese Dream, ed è un vero delirio. 4 milioni di copie vendute per un gran capolavoro. E sempre nel 1993 gli Smashing fanno la loro prima apparizione live in Italia, a Modena, al Festival Nazionale dell'Unità, per 2000 partecipanti che si possono godere un live show gratuito e al Fulmicotone. Nel 1994, grazie alla loro originalità e stravaganza, mettono a segno un altro colpo basso per la casa discografica. Contrariamente infatti alle leggi di mercato, che vorrebbero che il ferro venga battuto finché è caldo, a colpi di hit singles, gli Smashing Pumpkins fanno uscire Peaches Iscariots, una raccolta di B-sides e rarità, che negli Stati Uniti vende ben 1 milione di copie ed esce in una fantastica versione in vinile giallo trasparente per i collezionisti. E arriviamo per gli Smashing al 1995. Dopo un periodo di profondissima crisi del cantante e chitarrista Billy Corgan, non riusciva più a scrivere canzoni e il gruppo è stato sul punto di sciogliersi, arriva il poema epico degli Smashing Pumpkins, Melancholy and Infinite Sadness, un doppio CD al prezzo di uno solo per 2 ore di musica e 28 canzoni favolose.
Why did you guys decide to release a double CD album?
Darcy?
I'm really glad I'm not the end of this one. Why don't you take it, James?
Well, we had so much material. And we wanted to put it all on one big CD. But since you can't have one big CD like a laser CD, we had to make two of them.
What it inspired the writing and of this song? I mean, what are the sentiments or emotions or feelings that inspired?
Well, when you have no feelings, you
no.
You make up for it.
You make up for it.
On his back.
So I thought, you know,
Jack on his back.
When I have, you know, I have these no feeling periods, and 1994 and 95 seem to be those years, and wanted
a CD for each year.
I decided to just kind of supplant my feelings with songs, and so I thought, you know, happy song for when I need to be happy.
Before releasing this like double CD that it's like your masterpiece, you were in a deep like blackout, like in a creative like crisis. You couldn't like get inspired.
But I mean, to me, it's an odd question because 3 years ago I could write songs, and then the past year I wrote 40 songs. So
I know.
I'd rather focus about why I wrote 40 songs as opposed to why I didn't write any songs.
Tell me why you wrote 40 songs.
Because I have no life and I have a pathological need to create. Today you
in Italy, the price of your CD is very low. It costs about as much as a single CD. Why did you keep the price low? Was that your choice?
Yes.
Why?
To make it accessible.
We didn't want anybody not buying the CD or CDs because of the price, you know, because of the higher price. And that's why. We're more concerned about people hearing the music than about making money, so.
How do you come up with your songs? Like, I read that sometimes you dream about it, sometimes you just... How do you make your songs up?
It's kind of weird. I mean, sometimes I sit down and say, okay, I'm going to write a song today, you know, and I go, chinka, 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 and like, you know, sometimes it's good and sometimes it's bad. Other times, I'm thinking about taking the car in to get, you know, an oil change, and it's like, boom, something happens, you know, it's weird.
Who produced this album for you?
Flood.
Flood is your new producer.
And Dickie Betts.
Yep. And Alan Mulder.
And I read that you produced the other two albums, Gish and Sam's
Dream.
No,
I helped produce this one too.
You helped it.
Mm-hmm.
And you produced the other ones with Butch Wig, is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Why did you change producers? And how do you feel with this new producer? Work with this new?
Butch?
Yep.
Butch is cheesy. He's from Wisconsin. We just wanted a more cosmopolitan feel.
Well,
for
he's
this
in
record.
That, he's in that band Garbage.
Mm-hmm.
And Garbage was formed probably towards the end of 1993, and he told us Garbage is going to be bigger than the Smashing Pumpkins, so I can no longer help you because I need to be bigger than you and Garbage. So. We like the kind of work Flood had done because it was so experimental and diverse that we thought he could give it, you know, he could dress up the old horse. And
dress up as a what?
He could dress up the old horse, i.e. the band.
Oh, I thought you said he could dress up as a horse for us.
Yes, that too. He's that kind of guy. He'd do just about anything to get a sound. You know?
Do you spend a lot of time in the studio recording your last album?
Yes.
Not really.
These
no.
are two interesting answers.
Well, we spent as much time on the double CD as we did on Siamese Dream.
So to me, that's not
four
that
months,
long.
Five
I thought
months.
It was fast. 28 songs.
Put it that way?
So where were you, James? Well, there were
I was,
in the studio.
I was in my own mind.
Okay.
It was, it took longer.
Many people don't know this, but he's ranked in the top 10 in Frisbee in America.
Yeah.
So he kept taking off to go to the Frisbee competition.
And then I have to keep coming back for recording, so I got Frisbee meets. And then he had
problems with his wrist.
So that would take a little longer.
Do you play Frisbee with your dog?
Yes.
Is he good?
But the amazing thing
he's
is
learning.
Is he still doesn't have it down when the dog throws the Frisbee the jump. He can't get the timing down.
I mean, I jump, but he doesn't. I should go see you with you. Yeah, she knows. And she knows. She knows. She knows.
Do you like the studio work or not?
We like the food, you know.
Food?
Like
the food?
Like Starbucks.
Is always good. Yeah.
They have very good coffee.
It's kind of a different world, you know.
You know, there's like that. You know how that thing in America where they put the people in the biosphere, you know, and they close it and they have to breathe the same air and they grow with the plants. It's kind of like that.
Only it's full.
So
of
you just throw us in, yeah, smoke and a bunch of guitars, and we just breathe that.
Wait, now, so, what do you think of the studio, Darcy?
What?
What the studio.
Wait, just say something about the studio.
Yeah.
Wait,
we'll whose studio?
There. Your studio, the one where you record Melancholy.
Practice space?
No. Well, CRC either. Or, you know, recording, when we're recording.
Which is... I'd like to say hi to Hank.
Well, let's just go.
He's
on
a really nice
question.
Guy. He runs the studio there.
Okay. All right, so we were talking about Italian names or something.
So why do you think the alternative rock bands, American alternative rock bands don't like working in studios? Is that because of the rap sound?
Because it's hard to get drugs.
You know what do you mean?
Well, you know, they're usually downtown, you know, it's like people who do drugs live uptown.
Too many police
downtown.
A lot
of commuting.
You go there with your song ready and already. You do rehearsal before you get in the studio, or the rehearsal you do practicing the songs are actually in the studio.
But both.
Both.
Yeah, we did.
And
we
it still takes 16 hours a day to record it.
Yes.
Boy, it must be hard to be a musician.
It gets a little. The finger pointing gets embarrassing.
You,
musician. It's just we you know we have very high standards. So.
Everything takes time.
I mean we could record an album in a week. It just wouldn't.
Who gets the idea for it? Connecting all the effects or running backwards tracks or putting the effects into the mix. Who does it? You or the producer or whoever.
It depends
on
the part or just the nature of the song or you know, sometimes there's a specific part I'll come up with. Sometimes Billy have a specific idea of how the song will want to be or Flood will have an idea of how to arrange production of it. It depends.
You write a song and you have like this idea of your song. If Flood comes in and said, "Well, I would put that sound," are you like, "No, no way, that's my song, I want."
No, we're very open. I mean, we'll try anything.
You do? Yeah, that's what took so long. I tried so many things.
Are you always satisfied with the song you get, or sometimes you've imagined like this? Big melodies, the big songs, and you can't get it.
I used to feel that way, but I feel now I can pretty much get whatever I would want out of it.
What song did you imagine that could have been better in your imagination than in sound?
That's a good question. There's a couple songs in the new album that probably could have been better if we spent more time on them, but we had to make choices because there was so much material. So. It's hard to say of what's better. Sometimes you do something quick and it's good, and sometimes you spend forever and it sucks. So.
Are you always aware of what you represent to people? I mean, Do you know that Billy Corgan represent the like an alternative rock? The Smashing Pumpkins represent an alternative rock band and cannot play like a pop song or whatever. You just go ahead and write whatever you want.
Yeah, we don't care.
Aren't you afraid of what your fan can like think about it?
Well, if fans can't accept what the band puts out, then they're probably not really fans of the Smashing Pumpkins, because the Smashing Pumpkins doesn't stand and has never stood for one thing. If you listen to Gish, it's a lot of different songs. Siamese Dream, same thing. It's, you know, the same band that did Fuck You can do Disarm.
Yeah.
Two completely worlds apart, you know, and I think the people who really like us appreciate both. Yeah. And if not, whatever, you know, it doesn't really bother me. You may think that it's more direct, like you feel this and it connects to that, but it's not like that. It's more kind of spread out. You know, in the course of a show for an hour and a half, I mean, Jimmy doesn't feel every emotion of every song that he's playing, but I guarantee you there's a couple songs where it totally matches his mood, so he'll feel very intense emotion for those couple of songs, and I may feel intense emotion about a couple other songs.
The United States, but what are, is it hard to be an indie band in the United States?
You have to understand flannel.
You have to wear flannel, but it's difficult because America's so big that if you're an indie band and you're on an indie label, you know, someone across the country hearing about you chances are very small. So when we first started out, we were playing in we would go as far as Minnesota, which is maybe, you know, 800 miles away or whatever. And then, you know, so we'd go in a big circle and we would play around Illinois. And, you know, we would go to places and play in front of 5 people because no one had heard about us or no one had heard our record. In another place, we'd go and we'd play in front of 100 because somebody had played the record on the radio and people would come see us play. I mean, we'd do all those kind of hang-up flyers, and it was all kind of word of mouth, you know. Music is supposed to be a pleasurable, enjoyable experience. And the moment you start attaching ideas and relevance and cultural...
on rules.
Rules. It's what? Rock and roll. Who the fuck cares? You know what I mean? If it's good, it's good, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, Elvis sold a zillion records, and he put out some pretty good records. I still enjoy him. I don't care if he did coke and, you know, fuck dogs for all I care, you know?
Sometimes the major labels, like, wants you to do it, and if you don't, well, just let go. We don't want you.
So what?
I know, but sometimes a lot of some money going on.
No, I understand, but it's a big, cruel world, you know what I mean?
I know.
Money rules the world, you know? You know, if we didn't make people money, they wouldn't be interested in us. We wouldn't have the support that we have. We're in a lucky position to be successful and make great art, you know. If the commerce is going to compromise your art, then accept that you're not going to make any money. Me and James could have stayed in my bedroom and made tapes for the rest of our lives, you know. We did that. We spent a whole year in my bedroom making tapes for two, you know, here playing for my dad. I mean, you know. Was it fun? Yeah, we had fun. Was it as fun as this? No. I'd rather play for people. It's a lot more fun, I guarantee you.
What does the video Bullet with Butterfly Wings mean? I mean, there's all this, like, things going on and you don't really understand what's going on. What?
You're just, you know, you're just a rat in the shit.
Thanks.
You.
Me.
Yeah, you.
Not us.
Not us.
Not us.
Notice how we're not dirty.
We're in a rock band. We're playing in a quarry. They find this thing and there's this guy who's crazy and he throws his arms up in the air. He doesn't care about anything. He's happy. He's having fun. He wants to get these people going, so he's like getting them all mad, and we're rocking, you know? We're playing even harder and harder as the video goes on, and you can see the excitement in our faces, because the colors. And then we just let loose.
But at the end,
there's a calm.
He knows he's a rat in the cage.
He's still a rat. He's a goddamn rat.
And we've got the fucking keys.
We're not gonna let him in. We're gonna get some guy We're gonna get our manager. He's gonna open up the door with the keys, and then we're gonna shut the door really quickly.
I say good evening.
Buonasera.
Buonasera.
Is this an Italian interview?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Oh, jeez.
But we're actually talking in English, so don't worry.
But we're in France. How confusing is that?
Your songs are not about, like, social issues or political issues. What are they about?
Me.
They're not about social issues? No. You're kind of so... Oh, no, you're not really social.
I'm a socialist.
He's pretty anti-social. He's like a hermit.
Are you? What do you believe in? Nothing? Nothing at all? Not even music?
No. I believe in the complete absence of ideas. It works. Try it.
Are you gonna write some songs about believing things or not?
I think we did.
We pretty much covered the Oblivion, Abyss, Nietzschean Frontier.
Which song?
All of them.
All of them? They're all about Bolivians?
I thought they were all about love.
Whoa. Maybe they are.
Well, you're the one who writes them. You're the one supposed to know it.
No, I'm the one who pretends that I wrote them. Oh. The guy who really writes them is back home in Chicago.
Do you ever get vacation, holidays, or...?
Very few. We have worked almost 5 years straight.
We did?
With very few breaks.
And what do you like to do when you don't? When you get back from the studio, what do you like to do?
Pound my fists into my head.
Why?
Because it feels good.
Does it?
It removes the sound.
Okay. And
those voices, you know.
You're no good, you're no good, you're no good, you're no good, you're no good. Sometimes you're good, you're no good, you're no good, you're no good. Why'd you cut your hair? Why'd you cut your hair? Why'd you cut your hair? Why'd you cut your hair?
You don't have any plans for your future.
Do we have a future? Do you have a future?
I hope.
E sullo sfondo del maestosissimo Arc de Triomphe, purtroppo dobbiamo lasciare gli Smashing Pumpkins. Ciao da Alex, da Parigi e alla prossima. Non dimenticatevi di scrivere.